यस
ठीक है और
यस
बाद
यस
में
श्योर,
किसी और को।
वेट फॉर 2-3 और मिनट एंड विल बिगिन विद द सेशन। Fine, Partha, shall we begin?
Yeah, we can begin. Yes. Yes,
Yes, actually, I'm continuously getting approval that plenty of are in queue. Oh, okay, all right. Yes, good evening, everyone.
Shall I
Yes, yes,
start that?
I'm going to begin now. Yes, shall I? Partho? All right.
Yes, it. Yeah,
Yes,
please go
good
ahead.
evening, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar. I would like to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Partho Patel and Dr. Falgun Bhatt. So Partho Patel is the founder of Lux Sports and Rehab Center, which is based in Ahmedabad. Sorry, sorry. Actually, I'm continuously getting that. I had to approve the participant. That's why I'm continuously getting the pop-up. Yes, I would like to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Partho Patel and Dr. Falgun Bhatt. The Partho Patel is the founder of Lux Sports Rehab Center, which is based in Ahmedabad. Partho has experience as a practicing physiotherapist for almost 9 years in various cricket field for various age group. Since 2008, he has also served as a sports physio in Gujarat Cricket Association, Tripura Cricket Association, and Bengal Cricket Association. He is also appointed as a physiotherapist, sports physio from BCCI to various National Cricket Academy and Zonal Camp, Zonal Cricket Academy campus. He has also served as a physiotherapist for KKR Academy as well. Like there are plenty of there is a long list to explain, but we are having short of time. We'll brief later. And the physiotherapist who is Dr. Falgun Bhatt, who will be assisting Dr. Partho Patel for conducting your practical session. So I welcome all of you and special welcome to our speaker, Dr. Partho Patel and Dr. Falgun Bhatt. Now I would hand over this session to Dr. Partho Patel. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarfraz bhai, for my introduction. And I really want to tell sorry to our participants for some technical error was there, so couldn't able to come on time. Okay, so shall we begin our presentation? I'm just sharing my screen. Yes, Sarfaraz, can you see that screen? Hello? Everyone can see the screen, Sarfaraz bhai?
Yes, Partho, I can see. I hope
Yes,
everyone would be seeing.
Okay, so good evening, everyone. Hope everyone is fit and fine at your place during COVID's time. And we just chosen this topic, foam rolling and joint mobility. So before I start talking about this topic, I would like to say something regarding philosophy. Okay, what is my philosophy? So this is the slide. What you drown not by falling into the river, but by staying submerged in it. What I mean basically by this slide is basically you took as a physiotherapy as a, your career, as a profession. So if you stay in your profession, if you fall in profession, that's fine, you will not die. But if you don't update yourself, if you stay at the same place, if you don't move in your profession, you will die. So that's how I mean. The other philosophy I would like to share with everyone is, I heard from somewhere, is basically make your corner better, the world get better. So basically idea behind it, try to make yourself better, everything will falls into the better. Okay. Other one thing really want to share before I start my topic is a philosophy of my clinic, Lux Sports Rehab Center. So we have a two philosophy for a Lux Sports Rehab Center is, one, active therapy. So we try to make people to convert into the active life. We always recommend everyone to do stay active life and do physical activities. The second philosophy behind my physiotherapy, Lux Physiotherapy, is independent. So we just want to make people to independent rather than they depend on us physiotherapy. Like, so basically, if you suggest them active life, automatically they are independent in their life. So these are two philosophy which we follow in our rehab. Okay. So next slide. Yes. So we'll start with the fascia now. Just I want to brief before I start something. So I just want to explain about the fascia. So a definition of fascia, review of advance in facial research. Fascia is not a passive structure, but functional organ of stability and motion, virtually inseparable from all surrounding tissue. So earlier in 90s, people believed that fascia is passive structures. And as new research came, early of 2000, they come to know about the fascia is not a passive structures, that is active structures. Histological, if we think about that, it contains specific cell, ground substance, and fibers types. So basically, it's made up of collagen fibers, actin myosin filaments, GTO, extracellular matrix, elastic fibers. And there are different kind of fascia they have, like dense or loose connective tissue, unidirection and multi-direction. So basically fascia is a connective tissue which cover whole body from toes to the heads. Okay, so everyone knows about that fascia nowadays by Anatomy Train is one of the good book you can read regarding fascia if you want to know details about that. Yes. Other things, I want to classify fascia. If I want to classify fascia, we can classify into four. There are another classification also. Some of people, they classified fascia into two category, superficial and deep. But I would like to classify this fascia in functional classification. We call the functional classification, which is given by Federative International Committee on Anatomical Terminology. That is, one is linking fascia, second is fascicular, third one is compression, and the fourth one is separative. We'll go through some of that part, so we'll understand how we define this fascia. So name itself, it's suggesting linking fascia. Linking means which is connecting somewhere. So they have a two type of linking fascia, one dynamic, the second one is passive. So dynamic is basically, as it name itself suggests, that its function is movement, stability, force transmission, create significant pre-tension in musculature, Example of that fascia is fascia of pectoral muscle, supraspinatus, IT band, thoracolumbar area. The other one is passive. So passive fascia is basically, its function is maintain connectivities, passive force transmission, proprioceptives. An example of that fascia is fascia muscle of rectus sheath, cervical fascia, ligamentum favum, and anterior talofibular ligament. Next, fascicular fascia. Its function is myofascial force transmission, proprioceptive feedbacks for a movement and control. So protection, it's another function of protection of nerves and vessels. So example of this fascia is endomyosin, perimyosin, epimyosin, endotendons, peritendons, paratendons. So that basically serve as a main function of this fascia is to serve the protection from the nerves and vessels and different. Okay, next fascia, compression. Again, it may itself suggest compression is that function of this fascia is stocking, compression and tension compartmental effect, influence venous return, enhance proprioception, muscular efficiency, and the coordination. So example for the, this fascia, which is fascia which covered the brachial fascia, brachial, antibrachial fascia, dorsal fascia of hands, fascia lata. And next, last and next, separating. Separating, that will help to compartmentize the organs and body region to maintain the structure's function. And basically, main function of this fascia to limits the spread of infection from one part of the body to another part of the body. And other main function is of this fascia to promote the sliding and reduce the friction. So example of this fascia, parietal fascia, visceral fascia, and investing fascia. So I hope you understand, we have a four different type of fascia, that is linking, separating, compression, and fasciculars. Okay, I hope I'm not going too fast. I hope you are understanding what, and this is little bit boring stuff, always anatomical part and that. So I'm just trying to make it fast so we can focus on more practical stuff rather than this practical, this theoretical part. Okay, yes. We really need to understand pathomechanism of tissue contracture if we want to treat some tissues. So just general understanding. I made a one slide. Here I just mentioned about the one factor. There are so many other factors can cause this tissue contracture. So I'm just talking where we can use the foam rolling and mobility. So in this slide, I mentioned about that inactivity in certain range of motion of for a prolonged period of time, that caused the increase the myofibroblast, and then that increase the cross linkage of collagen, then increase the matrix remodeling, and that caused the cellular contraction, and that caused the tissue contracture, right? Yes. Now we'll come to the foam rolling, which is more interesting part of this webinar. And most of people know about the foam rolling, I hope. Nowadays it is really fancy stuff to understand. And before I'll move to the why I choose this foam rolling topic, I just want to tell you, as I already spoke about my philosophy about the physiotherapies, I just want to move into the active therapy. So you guys know about that, what situation we are going through, whole world is going through, is nowadays people are thinking how we can make it non-contact therapy. So we as a physiotherapist, we really need to think other way also. And earlier stage, we usually think about that how we'll do the manual stuff and that. But you guys may be knowing that in the future, people will not ready to take any manual stuff. And we are also scared to give some manual stuff. But it's not about the scare, or it's not about people are not willing to do. It's about how we can make it non-contact physiotherapy, where we can think about that, is it really necessary to manipulate that particular joints or manipulate that particular things? So I'll give you one of the example, what I feel in my physiotherapy career. In earlier of my physiotherapy career, I used to touch a body so frequently and so many times in after small. But as I learned that we no need to touch the body to understand their body. So same for the treatment also, we no need every time manual stuff. And we have a good evidence nowadays, active therapy is more beneficial rather than the passive therapy. So that's what I choose this. So what is foam roller? Basically, foam roller is a tools with hollow PVC pipe and outer ethyl foam. There are another material also they call the polyethyl, and there are so different kind of material they sell in the market nowadays. It tools which use mainly increase the range of motion and for a recovery. Another thing, roller comes in market with the different size, with the different material, like different size mean they have a main two sizes, 6 inch and 36 inch. Another one is the smaller one, the 6 inch and 18 inch. So nowadays, if you go to the Decathlon store or any other sports store, they have a different, so many different type of foam rollers. So rather than the, if you don't have a foam roller, we can use the tennis ball also. So there are another massage stick also you'll get into the market. So there are so many different equipment we can use for a rolling. Okay. The next I written in my slide, it has been used as a SMR technique. So what mean of the SMR is basically self myofascial release. So do you think we call foam rolling is a SMR, and people always consider foam rolling is SMR, but in my opinion, we don't consider foam rolling in SMR, because self myofascial release technique, where the evidence and research, they said that to change in fascia, it's not possible. We don't apply any enough stress or force, we can change the fascia, right? So that's why I don't consider foam rolling in SMR technique. So basically I'll explain why it is that and everything, what effect it's happening in. So next is mechanism of foam rolling. According to research, I just want to brief one more point. According to the research, Robert, because by doing the rolling, we cannot apply enough force to break the adhesion in your myofascia. That's why we are not calling this SMR technique, self myofascial release. Whatever I read about that, we require at least to change the facial mechanism or facial stuff. We require at least 800 Newton force, which is far more better than your body weight, or far more better than what you are applying to in a rolling. So basically you need supra physiological force in order to do anything with fascia or any muscle tissue. So that's why we are not considering this technique as a SMR. So now I'll move to the next part, mechanism of foam roller. So I written here thixotropic effect. What mean of thixotropic effect? So thixotropic effect, if I'll give you the example about this, I hope everyone have seen that. If you're trying to pour out the ketchup from the ketchup bottle, your ketchup bottle is, you not use your ketchup bottle since long, and you're trying to pouring out the ketchup from the bottle, it's not coming out, right? Then what you do? You try to shake it, that bottle, and then try to pour it out, and then you see that it is coming out. So what reason it is coming out? So when you first time when you pour it, it not came out because the viscosity of ketchup was more. So that's why it won't come out. But second time when you shook it up, what you did, basically you added stress and strain in a ketchup. So which reduce the viscosity of the ketchup, and then it come out. The same thing we are doing with the foam rolling. So when you're rolling your muscle or when you're rolling the tissue, what you are doing, you are just adding the stress and strain on your muscle tissue. So that will reduce the viscosity. As you know that all connective tissue and all muscle tissue are made up of, is a viscous and are made up of most of water and fibers. So that by rolling that part, you are reducing the viscosity. And then you increase your range. It's not you are changing any fascia or you are not changing any kind of tissue. So understand that it's really necessary. You are just changing the viscosity of muscles. That's why it's increasing the range of motion, or it's giving the some effect on the body. I hope it makes a sense what I'm talking about that. Now, we really need to understand next part, benefit of foam roller. Benefit of foam roller. I mentioned about increase the joint range of motion. So almost every study show as increase in range of motion, even 5 seconds of foam rolling can increase the range of motion. But that increased range of motion is acute effect, not is a training. There are two effects, acute effect and training effect. We call the acute effect means it lasts for some time by doing that. Training effect means by doing that activities, it remains for a longer time. So what found in research, they said that effect remain for acute time only. I'd say that if you're doing the foam rolling for 5 seconds, they seen that increase in range of motion. For example, if you're doing the rolling of your hamstring muscle, you can increase your knee range, you can increase your hip range, but that lasts for some times only. Second, why it is increasing the range of motion? I said that it could be one of the reason because you are reducing viscosity of the tissue. Sometimes another reason is by reducing the pain or something like trigger points. By increasing the blood circulation to that muscles that causing the increasing range of motion. So rolling of muscle, there is one interesting study found that increase in hip, knee, ankle range of motion after doing. So can we do some practical, so at least you can understand rather than I keep talking. I just want to try one thing. Can you stand up? Everyone, can you stand up? Yes. Yes, guys, can you stand up at your place? Now try to touch your toe. And where you are able to reach. At your knee, at your mid part of your legs, at your ankle, at your toe, or at your grounds. Now just stand up straight. Do you have a tennis ball? I think that keep it with you at least. So now can you roll your fascia? I'm just showing my range first. What you need to do? Try to touch your toe. I'm able to touch my toe till this part. Okay. Now what I'll do? I'll just roll my plantar fascia for 30 seconds. Slow and nice. And I apply little bit pressure which leg I'm rolling. Okay. Yes, keep going. Good, nice and easy. Yeah, good. 5 seconds more. Good. Now turn on other leg. Now roll your other foot. And rolling your fascia, nice and easy. Apply little bit pressure, not too much. Good. Slowly. Nice. Yeah. Good, keep going. 10 seconds more. Nice, very good. Now try to touch your toe. You can see ample improvement in your range of motion, okay? So that's what I want to make you to understand what foam rolling does help you. So you have seen that it increases the range of motion. So there are another technique also that can help you. But we can use this technique as a part of your treatment. So that's why it increases your joint range of motion, right? Yeah. Second point is post-exercise muscle recovery. So one of researchers, McDonald, he explained about that he did the exercise induced muscle damage program. So it consists of 10 set of 10 repetition of back squats. They did with the two group. One group is control, one experimental group. They asked one group to do the 10 repetition of 10 set of 10 repetition of back squats with 60% of 1 RM. And then what they did is they did the foam rolling at after immediately of 10 set of 10 repetition of squats, then 24 hours of, and then 48 hours, and then 72 hours. And they check the outcome through the thigh girth, muscle soreness, knee range of motion, maximum voluntary contraction for knee extensors, neuromuscular activities measured via the EMG. And what they found is, so in experimental group, they use the foam rolling for 20 minutes at zero immediately after the exercise, after the 24 hours of the exercise, after the 48 hours of the exercise, and after the 72 hours of the exercise. They asked all athletes to do the 20 minutes of foam rolling. In that, they did the anterior thigh foam rolling, posterior thigh foam rolling, inner thigh foam rolling, and the outer thigh foam rolling. Protocol of that foam rolling is 45 seconds each muscle group with 15 second break in between, and two sets of each muscle group they did. And what result found there, after the foam rolling, reduced the subject pain level at all post-test point, like after the exercise, 24 hours, 48 hours, and 72 hours. Also, they found improving in vertical jump immediately after the exercise, after doing the foam rolling. After doing foam rolling, they found the muscle activation of the joint range of motion. So that's why, so if you use the foam roller immediately after the exercise, after the 24 hours, after the 72 hours, 48 hours and 72 hours, that will help you to increase the muscle recovery. Okay. Then another points they found is reduction of the DOMS also. So you must be observed, if you given some of the rehabilitation, patients complain next day, I have a pain. They usually say that pain in muscles. So we explain them that is DOMS, basically that is soreness. You have not done the exercise since long. So nowadays, that's why your body is responding. So there is one research, they said, if you have a DOMS, and if you try to do some exercise, your force of contraction 35% reduced. So that's why subsequently exercise benefit is reduced. So that's why we need to find out some technique where we can reduce the DOMS, especially in athletes or especially in anyone who are suffering from any pains or in your rehabilitation. Okay, so for a reduction, it's also foam rolling also helps to reduction of the DOMS. So same things they done with the 8 male subjects. They done with one research, like 8 male subjects were tested for a 2 condition, a DOM exercise protocols followed by the foam rolling. Then they done with the 4-week distance, like they did one for 8 subjects without foam rolling. They tested some outcomes. What are the outcomes they tested? I'll just explain you. Pressure pain threshold of quadriceps using an algometer, then 30 meter sprints. They check the standing broad jump and T test. So what they did, they tested after 4 weeks, and they try to do the foam rolling at immediately exit after the exercise, then 24 hours, then 48 hours, and then 72 hours. And before 1 month, they did not use the foam rolling. And after foam rolling, they tested this all outcome. And what they found, reduce the pain level at the post point in the same group after doing the foam rolling, and improvement in performance, like they increase the vertical, increase in broad jump, increase in T test, so reduction of timing of the T test. So that shows that reduction of the DOMS. Of course, this research also say the next topic, muscle performance. Keeping the same one, yes. So muscle performance. So it increase your muscle performance also. the same articles explain about that why it is increasing the muscle performance. The another real time one experiment has been done by David Bain. So what was the experiment they done with the football team. So what they seen, they found the player are sitting in the half time, and they check with the all players that they found that determinant effect or the performance in second half because of they are sitting in half time. So they thought that what can be done for that. So what they did, they asked that players to do the foam rolling in half time, and then they checked the determinants in second half. So they found that the reduction of the determinant in second half. So that's why you can use the foam roller in half time also. So that again shows that increase the muscle performance. Okay, so basically that helps you to increase the joint range of motion, help you to post exercise muscle recovery, reduction of DOMS and muscle performance. Yeah, next. So clinical application, guys, which is really need to understand where we can use selection criteria. I mentioned about the selection criteria means where we can use the foam rolling. For me and my practical knowledge is basically we use selection criteria into basically in a warm up part of your rehab, or any person who have a asymmetry, any person having some kinetic issues, a person having some trigger points, someone coming to you and before your rehab someone coming and telling you to I have some soreness in my muscle, we can use it for that. Other thing you really need to know about that exclusion criteria where we should not at least use before. So any bony prominent area, any structures, superficial neural structures area, like especially back of your knee, in armpit, in neck area. So we should avoid doing this foam rolling in that area. Any swollen area we should avoid, any open wound area we should avoid. We should think about in some geriatric condition, like person who's having some varicose problem, we should avoid using this foam rolling. In a fracture case, we should avoid that foam rolling. Yes. So now, next type of roller, we need to understand type of roller. We'll explain you more into the practical also. We have a next slide about the practical stuff. So guys need to, we have a two different type of foam roller. One less density and one is more density. So we need to choose according to the subject there. So if athlete is there, I use always dense foam roller, which is more effective. But if some geriatric person is coming, if subject is 70 years old, and if I want to make him to do the foam rolling, I'll use less dense foam roller because that can give you the acute soreness for them. So try to understand that where we should use the foam roller. Another type of foam roller, there are so many different type of foam roller in market. One is new one, if you can heard about that vibration one foam roller, vibrator, we call the vibrator foam roller. So I always tell the athletes vibrator foam roller can be used in a recovery rather than in warm up, because vibration have a good effect in your neural recovery. So post exercise and post activity, I usually prefer vibrator foam roller. Duration of foam roller, they said that 60 second foam rolling off for each muscle group. But as I said that in research, they said 5 second can be give you the increase in range of motion. But most of time we tell that 30 second of each muscle group should be done. And in the duration, I'll explain there is another things we need to take care about that cadence of foam rolling. Cadence means how you're doing, how speedy you are doing. So for a thighs muscle, I can say that 1 second going down and 1 second going up. So 1 second towards the ankle, 1 second towards the head. So that give you more effect of foam rolling. And timings. So timings I might explain. Usually I tell the people to do the foam roll before I'll ask them to walk at least 5 minutes, do some cardiac work and then do the foam rolling rather than starting with the foam rolling. And after immediately your exercise, you can do the foam rolling. So next slide is more interesting, practical layer. And I will invite Falgun to explain about this. So he's my colleague, and he's working with the ARA team, football team, and he's most experienced person. So he'll explain about the practical stuff. So practical layer, which is more interesting. Yes, Falgun.
Hello everyone. I hope you all are enjoying it. I'm going to show some foam roller techniques, which will definitely help you and your patients also. So here the first one, foam rolling for the ITB. First, you need to place the foam roller on the IT bend, not on the bony prominence. You can use your second leg to support and to move front and backwards. You just need to maintain the angle of your toe downwards and try to move forward and backward. Just make sure you are not compressing your bones and you are not putting pressure on your joints. Second one, this is the same video, but it is the side view, so you can understand what is actual position of the foam roller and actual position of the body. This rolling technique will help you in knee pain, even back pain patients, and some of the ankle injuries also. Next, it is dynamic cords technique. In this technique, you need to find any trigger points which is already there in your cords. So first of all, you need to move a little bit. And here I just found my trigger point. You just need to hold that position and you just need to move your distal joint. Here I'm moving my knee joints. You just need to flex and extend it. This just looks very easy, but once you will do it, you will feel how hard it is. And somebody have asked that how it feels when trigger point is getting released. So I would like to answer it right now that it is very painful. If you are doing it in the correct way, you definitely help your patients by reducing that trigger point, but make sure you are not putting too much pressure and converting it to an injury. Next, I'm using a hard ball to release glute muscle. It is a hockey ball, which we usually use in our clinic. You can use tennis ball also. This will definitely help you in some ankle case, some back pain related cases. It will release your glutes. You just need to place the ball above the pocket area and start moving laterally in this position. And same thing, if you find any trigger points over there, you just wait for 5 seconds, put pressure over that trigger point and release it. This is the most difficult one, legs, because the position is very complicated. You need to be on the sideline position with bend your knees, bend your elbows, both elbows. You just need to lift from upper torso and roll out on the legs. Try to avoid the bony prominent area. And if it is very painful, you can manually release also. But I always prefer to start with this technique. This will help you to increase shoulder joint range of motion in some of the frozen shoulder case if you are not targeting your legs, it will definitely affect your joint range of motion. And next one, which is pectoral release, in which I'm using foam roller and ball, both. I'm placing it. Here, you just need to move your arms upward. Make sure your body is in line. You are not leaning forward. And move slowly and gradually. This release will definitely help you in some of the very common trapezius. I would like to correct myself, trapezitis, which is not a correct term. Upper neck syndrome will definitely help you in this position. Okay, I would like to hand over Partha sir about joint mobility. Thank you so much, sir.
Hello. For a great practical stuff. So guys, we just try to cover up every different type of foam rolling style. We didn't cover the whole area, but you know that it's not possible to cover the whole things in small time. So we just try to show you some different type of foam rolling technique, which you can use for your patients by making your own ideas and by doing them. So make sure about that. Okay, so we'll move to the next topic before joint mobility. So I want to guys to move for, before we start joint mobility, just can you stand up and sit? Can you stand up guys and sit? I want to do some mobility stuff before we start. Yes, just stand up. Try to touch your toe, then sit down fully. Make sure that you hold your toe with hands and then try to straighten your knee. Then lift your hands up, turn by turn, right and left, and then stand up. Try for 5 times. Again, touch your toe, sit down fully, then make sure that you hold your toes. Now lift your hips up, then hang, and then up. So that's what I want to tell you before I speak anything about the mobility. I just want to make you to feel that. So you guys, now you understood about the mobility, right? So what is mobility? Basically mobility. So as in slide, I'll just mention about that. Flexibility. What is the flexibility? Flexibility is ability of muscle to lengthen. And mobility. Mobility is ability of joint to move actively through range of motion. So if you see, if you consider the part, problem of the patient is more mobility rather than the flexibility. So if you ask patient what is your problem, they'll say you that I couldn't able to sit down, I couldn't able to move, I couldn't able to climb a stair, I couldn't able to climb down the stairs, something like that. So all require the mobility rather than the flexibilities. So another real example I just want to discuss. Anyone observe that? Anyone ask your patient to touch your toe? They are not able to touch the toe. And if you ask patient to lie down straight on a couch, and if you ask them to raise your leg straight leg raise, they are able to take till 80 degrees. So what is that difference? So they have a good length of hamstring, but they don't have a mobility. So that could be mobility, that lacking of mobility is, could be from the muscles, could be from the joints. So I want to explain about that. So joints, if there is something with the joint, we need to identify, is it geometry? Like we have a hinge joints and different. So because of that, or coherency, so articular surface or anything that causing the joint mobility, reduction in joint mobilities. The another is capsular ligamentous factors. So these three factors can be cause the limitation of the joint range of motion. So now think about the muscles. If it is not joint, then muscles. So if you think about the muscles, so there are two things. One, active tension in muscles, or second is passive tension in the muscle. So both can be cause the reduction in the muscle's length. One, passive tension means muscle has a viscoelasticity property, which we discussed in the firm rolling. So that provides the passive tension in muscles. So anything change in viscoelasticity can cause the reduction in the range of motion. Another active tension is neuroreflexivity of the muscles. So as you everyone know that there is a neuroreflection property of the muscles. So that can be caused like that can be like a, as a spasm or can be as a voluntary contraction. As you know, guys, that muscle tension as a active and passive. So active basically how it's work. They have a two neuron, alpha neuron and gamma neurons. So alpha neuron usually under control and gamma neuron work as a reflective. And muscle tension passively, basically they have muscle viscosity and the fascia. So there is something wrong with the viscosity and fascia. That could be the passive tension causing that. So how the length is varying. So what is tightness? The shortening of the length basically depend on the muscle tension. If muscle tension increase, length will decrease. If muscle tension decrease, length will increase. So that is the stuff. Always we need to understand that part. Okay. Now next. So how we can increase the joint range of motion? So one of part is basically by doing the stretching. So we need to understand which kind of stretching we need to do. So here I mentioned about type of stretches. There are three type of stretches: one, static stretches, dynamic stretches, and pre-contraction stretch. Okay. So static stretch, they have an active and passive static stretch. In a dynamic, we have an active dynamic stretch and velocity stretch. Pre-contraction stretch, PNFs and the MET, other means MET. In a PNF, we have a contract relax, hold relax. And in another, we have a MET and post facilitation technique, which use for a stretching, for a different purpose of that stretching. So now when you consider range of motion, so what does it mean? What does it mean? Like if anything, if decrease in range of motion, as I explained that, that could be range of motion decrease could be from joint or could be from muscles. So how will identify in clinic? It is from joint or it is from muscles. So what we do, usually we just try to check the range of motion only. If, for example, if you think about the hamstring, if I want to find out the hamstring tightness, how I'll check? I always try to check knee extension test or SLR test. So that is again range of motion test. So on that we are not confirming that it is tightness in muscles only. That could be from the joints and that could be from muscles also. And muscle also, they have a two different structures. So we need to consider that muscle part or tendinous part. So for that, they said that there is what can be done in that range of motion can be increased. Then we can check the passive resistance measurement. So we need to apply the force throughout the range and we need to check the tension in muscles. And another is elasticity measurement of the tendon can be checked by applying some force, and you can do the ultrasound, real ultrasound, and then you can check extensibilities of the tendon. Extensibilities of tendon is basically stretching property of the tendon. So you need to understand that part, really understand whether it is muscles or joints. So by that way, you can identify what is exact problem. Is it problem with the joints or is it problem with the muscles? So I'll just discuss about the previous slide now. So if you think about that, if you find out in assessment, there is some joint issue like capsular ligamentous factor. So I always recommend treatment for ligamentous factors. We do the manual stuff like mobilization, or can be used as a mobility. Mobility can help you to stretch your structures. We cannot change the geometry and coherency. Now we think about the muscles. So if it is something with the passive tension, So what does it mean? How it increase the passive tension, viscosity change. So what happens if you sit in long, if you sit in one position for longer time, or if you are not using some of the range of motion of your joints for longer time, that tissue get shortened. So that increase the passive tension in that tissue and causing the limitation of the range of motion. So that time we preferred some static stretch or some PNF stretch, which can help you to increase the range of motion. If it is active tension, like it is a, for example, I have some low back pain and there is a spasm in my back and I couldn't able to move, like I couldn't able to move my spine, like I couldn't able to flex my spine. So we can't go for the range of motion immediately. In that scenarios, we need to stabilize the spine. That could be one of the sacroiliac instabilities causing the stress on the facet joint. So we need to understand right cause and then give the treatments for that. Okay, I hope it is clear for everyone. Maybe you guys, maybe you come across this approach, which is given by the Gray Cook and one of the renowned strength and conditioning coach who derived this concept is they call the joint by joint approach. So why in that slide now I'll explain you. So in every joint they don't require too much mobility. So we need to understand some joints are required stability also, and some joints needs more mobility. So here I just given one picture of body where we'll understand, like ankle is primary required a mobility. So whatever injuries happen in a body, most of time there is a reduction in dorsiflexion and cause, but not every time, most of time, I'm talking about most of time. In a knee, we require a stability rather than the mobility. In a hip, we required again mobility rather than the stability. In a lumbar spine, we require a stability rather than the mobility. So people I've seen that who try to focus on the spine mobility, lumbar spine mobility. But I always recommend focus on the thoracic mobility and hip mobility, which give you good result rather than just focusing on the lumbar spine mobility. So focus on the lumbar stability and focus on your thoracic spine mobility and the hip mobility will give you a good result, especially in chronic case. And then thoracic, yeah, we required a more mobility. Spine required a stability. If you derive scapula, it's required a stability, and glenohumeral required a more mobility rather than the stability. So now you can understand and you can divide your treatment according to this concept. So if someone have a knee problem, so I can focus on ankle mobility rather than knee mobility, and I can focus on hip mobility, and I'll try to focus on the knee stability. Okay, yeah. Next, I'm getting so many questions, but I couldn't able to answer every question right now. I'll try to cover up end of my this presentation. Okay, yes. So we need to understand benefit of joint. Okay, mobility. What benefit we get? So as a joint mobility, I'll say that we should use well-rounded exercise program. Like American College of Sports Medicine recommend 2 to 3 days per week, we should do the stretching program. We should hold for 15 to 30 seconds hold for each muscle and 2 to 4 repetition for each muscle. So that they recommended we should do special stretching program. It's like part of your program. It should be a specific, like we have a strength program, we have a some conditioning program. We should make sure that we should keep it specific 30 minutes or a specific 20 minutes stretching program separately. So in that we recommend 2 to 3 times in a day, in a week, 15 to 30 second hold for each muscles and 2 to 4 repetition of each muscles. Then that we need to consider some of the factors, especially like age. So in older age, they required a more hold, a longer hold than the younger one. So they done the research and they found that for older age people, at least 60 seconds we need to hold that stretch, that give you the, like they have done the research on the hamstring flexibility, they ask one group to hold for 30 seconds, they ask one group to hold for 60 seconds, and they got good result with the 60 seconds. So for a younger, if you found some patients who are more older, we should recommend 60 seconds for them. Another, there is a sex related, we need to consider the sex also, like person who is a person is a man and old people, we should recommend contract hold relax technique rather than static stretching. For a woman and old people, we should recommend them static stretching, so they have more benefit of the stretching. So we need to consider the age as well as the sex also when you prescribing stretching program. So these are the consideration we really need to look into that. So now another benefit is we can use mobility in a warm up of sports on earth ice. So in a warm up, they said that we need to identify which sports they are playing. So people always ask that there is a good research. They said that there is no difference between the static stretch and dynamic stretch. Only if you are doing the static stretch initially, they have a determined effect on the muscles. So that's why we are not using pre-exercise that exercise. So increasing range of motion, they both are effective. So if you use the static stretch or if you use the dynamic stretch, both are effective to increase the range of motion. Only minus point for the static stretch is basically determinant of the muscles. But there is one more research, they said if you do it the jogging and then do the static stretching, there is no determined effect in the muscle. So we need to consider that part also. So my opinion is we need to consider which sports he's playing. If person is into the gymnastic and dance, we recommend always pre-exercise static stretch rather than the dynamic stretch. But person who required a running and jumping performance like a cricket, basketball, we required always dynamic stretches as a warm-up. So what I usually recommend in our practice, we always recommend 5 minutes walk, then do the foam rolling, and then do the dynamic stretching, and then do the specific skill warm-up. Like for a cricketer, we ask them to catch ball, or we ask them to bat, or bowler has to ball 3 balls. So this is where we consider this part, okay? Next benefit of this mobility is rehab. We can use it in rehab also, but need to understand what purpose. Like if you want to increase the flexibility, static stretch is always helpful, and you can, where you are using in rehab, that is very necessary. If you are using the static stretch, you know that after static stretch, 15-20 minutes, there are determinant of muscle performance that will reduce the effect of the muscle performance. So like they did the research after static stretch, they check vertical jump and that other parts, so that will reduce. So they check the they did the dynamic stretch, and then they again check the same things. They did not found any change, but there wasn't any negative effect on the muscles. So that's why they recommend dynamic if you are using running or jumping and everything activities. So make sure about that, which, how are you using, what time you are using stretching. It's not any one stretch only use. You use different type of stretch. Like for example, if I'm training in one knee patient, a knee pain case, I want to make a rehab for him, I'll recommend ankle mobility before the knee strengthening exercise or hip strengthening exercise. And after knee strengthening and hip strengthening exercise, I recommend static stretch of the muscles, hamstring and hamstring or other part of. So that way we can consider that part. So stretching appears to have no benefit for neurological patient who have had a stroke and spinal cord injuries. I have come across one research. I'm not expert who can comment on the neurological disorder because I have not been studied that. I have not been practiced. But I come across one point as someone asked one question in my Google. So that's what I mentioned, but I'm not sure about that. You need to read some of the article what they say. But this is one point I know, so I just mentioned about that. Next slide. So where we can use the mobility? I already explained too much about that, how I can use mobility in my part, or where we can use. So especially increasing the range of motion, if you want to increase the range of motion in your rehab part, using mobility as an dynamic or as an static both or as an PNF technique. Someone who is having a, like for example, someone having a TFL tightness, you can use hip mobilities to increase the range of hip, range of motion to reduce the anterior knee pain. So most of like, I can say that including in a warm up, including in rehab part, or including the increasing the muscle performance also. Like they have done the research, if you do the mobility and then if you do the lunge test, there is a far better in what we can say, there is more better EMG activities in lunge person who doing the good hip mobilities before the lunge. So that's why it's really helpful to activate your muscles also rather than just increasing the range of motion. Exclusion, you need to take care about the fracture, especially in stable joints, initial phase of muscle strain. Like if you got some hamstring strain, so I always prefer don't use it in initial phase, hamstring mobility. Then targeted joints, identify which joints is required. So I mentioned about the joint by joint approach. If you have a knee pain, no need to do the knee mobility. You need to take care about the hip range of motion, can be ankle range of motion. Okay. And then position, try to identify the position, which position is useful. Like someone cannot be do the, like for ankle mobility, they cannot do in weight bearing. We can do the in, we can do in a half kneeling position or something like where we can reduce the weight on the ankle. Then repetition sets, usually they recommend 2 sets, which give you a good effect. Repetition, they said the 15 to 20 repetition, can be 10 to 20 repetition. It's very in a static stretch. They said that hold 30 to 60 seconds. As I described, you need to consider what age they are and what sex, like women's, they are more beneficial with the static stretch. Aged women's and the aged men's more beneficial with the hold relaxed technique. Repetition I mentioned, duration and direction, we need to consider which direction we should do. Like for example, if someone anterior instability is in shoulder, so we don't need to do it in standing pack mobility. We can do the pack mobility in 4 point with the trunk rotation. So that will not stress the, so that will reduce the chance of anterior impingement syndrome. Okay. I hope I cover everything. So next is practical, which is more interesting rather than. I call my colleague Rudra. He'll explain you about the practical. He is working in PTH since long, last 6-7 years, and he's more experienced in sports also. So he'll explain you practical stuff. Thank you guys. I'm over to Rudra.
Hello everyone. Sarfaraz bhai, I hope I'm audible to everyone. Can you please respond to my
yes comment, yes please? Rudra, I can hear you, it is audible.
Okay, yeah. thank you. So here we are going through some ankle mobility, and they are basic yet effective exercises. Okay, so here is the first one. The first one is a half kneeling dorsiflexion. Okay, that is the wall mobilization, and there it is. Okay, so what you need to do here, you just need to go in a half kneeling position, and your target should be just tap your knee to the wall, and your toe should be 2 to 3 inches away, minimum 2 to 3 inches away from the wall. Okay, and just tap your knee to the wall. Okay, that is a most basic ankle mobility exercise. Okay, excellent. Okay, so sometimes we can use a dowel as well for the same purpose, and there you have to just place your dowel in front of your second or third toe. okay, and move your knee outside the drawer like this. We have the another view as well. Okay, so here the dowel give us some benefits, like it will help to maintain a neutral arch position, okay, of your foot. Okay, the arch here is the neutral one. Okay, it's not too fat or exaggerated curve is observed. Okay, it also helps to avoid the compensation by overpronation. Okay, overpronation of your foot as well as internal rotation of your feet. Okay. Basically, it reduces the valgus force of your ankle. Simple. So the third one here, this is the ankle dorsiflexion with the band. We can also know it as a Mulligan concept, movement with mobilization. Okay. I hope everyone is. Okay, we can see lots of questions over here, but I have some time constraints and I have to cover this one, and our top order batsman will cover all the questions. Okay. Okay, so here is the movement with mobilization. What we are doing here is we are just pulling the talus posteriorly. Okay. So we can achieve some more range of the dorsiflexion. Okay. Okay. This could be beneficial in such condition like anterior ankle impingement. Okay. Sometimes you feel the pinch in front of the ankle. Okay. The tight joint restriction in front of your ankle. Okay. There is the lateral view. Okay. Here the dowel is just for the support only. Okay. So the another one. Okay. Here the toe is extended. Okay. The dorsiflexion with the toe extension. So here we are doing the same movement with the toe extended, okay, with the weight plate, or you can help the towel fold as well. Okay, this will also help to stretch your plantar fascia, your improvement in your toe extension as well. And the last one, this is toe elevated squats. Good. And well performed by our senior Prasu Patel. There's the front view. Okay, so thank you everyone. I hope these all are very fruitful to you all. Okay, over to Parsal sir.
Thanks for having a good session, practical. I hope you guys enjoyed that. So basically, idea was that we can't cover everything. We just show you how we can use the ankle mobility with the progression. So we started with the half line mobility and how you can consider different part, like we use the dowel. If you found a person having a knee pain with the valgus, like we see women have a more dynamic valgus, while
walking or while stair climbing. So you can use this ankle mobility by dowel, so maintaining the valgus. This different way you can use this mobility in different patients, and you need to choose the right things. Okay, so before we start, yeah, last slide. So take home message from my side is there is no only one solution for everything and for everyone. So we need to identify what is suitable for whom and which technique is suitable for. So all techniques are complementary, since it influences. It means that there is no any superior technique. Like people keep asking that static stretching is more beneficial or dynamic. There is no any technique is more beneficial. We need to understand what time it is used and how it is used, how we can use in rehab. So that's how we need to understand this part. Okay. These are the reference and question. So I'll try to answer the question which I'll read from the message. Okay, one Shruti Desai's question. So sir, foam roller helps to agitate and loosen the facial fibers, which I already explained you. The research say we can't give you enough force. We can't change fascias structures, histological or anything like, or else while doing the mobility also we cannot increase the muscle length. We can increase the extensibility, not muscle length. We can say the muscle length increase if we increase the sarcomere into the muscles, that we can call the increase in muscle length. But by doing the mobility or by rolling, we cannot change the fascia fibers or not change in muscles. We required so much force to change in 1% of the tissue. Okay, then. Can say second, yes, I learned earlier was in video accounts of or Dharmesh. If you see any acute case, disc prolapse case, we cannot start straight away. But if you see the non-specific low back pain in chronic case, so they have a lots of tightness in hip. They have a lots of tightness in calf muscle. They have lots of tightness in thoracic area. So if you do the thoracic mobility, if you do the hip mobility, if you do the foam rolling of thighs, if you do the foam rolling of glute, will help you out in that scenarios. And if someone just recovered from the surgery or after fracture, is stretch helpful? Yeah, of course, because the one function of the stretch is to align the tissue also. Benefit of the stretches is, but we need to understand which kind of stretch is required after the fracture. So in which stage of the fracture we need to use the stretch. Not we can start with the dynamic movements and then gradually we can increase the hold for that fracture case. Okay, how do we determine the resistance of bend? I didn't get the question. Can you ask again, Kenny Pandya? How do we determine the resistance of the bend? Okay, Shruti, again I'll explain you that thixotropic effect, or basically what is thixotropic effect. As I said, thixotropic effect is that will reduce the viscosity of tissue. That means that will reduce the fluid what contain type of fluids, so that will change the fluidity of the muscles, not the muscle sarcomere or not the facial changes. So that give you the temporary effect, so that will, that you can stretch. Like again, if you put the ketchup bottle at same place for longer time, again it become the viscous, thicker or dense. So once again after so many days, if you using again, you need to soak it. You need to shake it that bottle, and then only you can pour it ketchup out of the bottle. The same way we need to keep moving our body. So if you don't want to make your tissue dense, or if you don't want to increase the viscosity or density in fascia, what you need to do, you need to keep moving your body. That's it. Simple. Sir, how would can foam rolling be given on ankle just after ankle sprain? It cannot be given to the ankle, but foam rolling can be used after the ankle sprain on foam roller. Another things we really need to consider when you're doing the foam rolling, we don't recommend foam rolling more on tendinous area. We recommend more foam rolling on the muscular area because tendon is always made up of the harder one. Like as people say, okay, IT band is tight. IT band should be tight because their function is to stabilize the patella. Same thing like Achilles tendon function is to stabilize the ankle. So if I loosen up the tendon, it is not good for them. And tendon always, if you read the research of Jill Cook, they said that tendon only one thing in a tendon always don't like one thing, change. So don't try to rub it too much tendon. So don't use it for tendon. So in ankle sprain, roll the plantar fascia, roll the calf muscles, roll the peroneal muscles rather than rolling the ankle. So don't roll on the joints, okay? Nice. Okay. So while ankle dorsiflexion with band, how do you determine the resistance of band? So why we use the resistance in a ankle mobility? Basically, if you see in clinical things, so after ankle sprain or anything, there are two chances. If your ligament is hardened, or you have a scar tissue in ligament, and if you do the dorsiflexion mobility, that will impede the soft tissue under the anterior talofibular ligaments. Or else there is one anterior area of the joints, ankle joints, is a synovial membrane. So there is any irritation of the synovial membrane, if you do the dorsiflexion mobility, that will irritate. So that will cause the pain. So reducing that, and another research, they said that in ankle sprain, there is a fibula, anterior position of the fibula. In a chronic ankle sprain, there is always, they found the anterior position of the fibula. So by using this TheraBand, we are just pushing the fibula back and tibias little bit back, and we are increasing the space between the ankle joints. So you need a little bit harder TheraBand to just push. Like you can use the mobilization belt also if you don't have a TheraBand. So we call the power band rather than the TheraBand base. So use the harder one, not the softer one. Okay. Yes. Can we? I hope it is satisfactory for you. I think I covered all question. Any other question, Sarfaraz bhai?
Yes, students, any questions from your side, or shall we proceed for the end? Fine. I hope we hope like all the questions are covered by Parthav. Yes. Fine. Yes. Before we proceed for end, I would love to have our respected principal sir on screen. Sir, please, please. Say a few words. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, all of you, students, staff.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir. How are you?
Thank you for joining from beginning. Actually.
Yeah. Yeah. It is a very very important session. And this foam rolling is very important for clinical practice, all students. So keep in touch with Sarfaraz sir and this is our speaker, and get another ideas also with these techniques. Okay. And sure. Thank you so much, sir, for taking this lecture for our students and staff.
My pleasure, sir.
Yeah, and keep in touch with our students and staff also, sir, please. Thank you so much, sir.
Sure.
On behalf of our BITS family. And thank you, sir. Sarfaraz sir is very enthusiastic for this type of webinar, and he has conducted very well. So thank you, Sarfaraz sir, also, and all staff also, who has taken the part of this very good webinar, and students also. Students, wish you all the best. God bless you. Thank you, all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your kind words.
One more thing. I hope it is a surface. I'll just let me speak about that. I just would thanks to the Rudra and Falgun who helped me a lot in this presentation. And one more thing, if you guys have any question in future, you can follow on the Lux Insta and Facebook. As I don't have my personal Insta and Facebook, I'm not in social media. So please, you can put your inquiry or you can put your queries or you can put your question on Lux Insta and Facebook. So we'll hopefully answer you and we'll get back to you about that. Thank you. And I really enjoyed. I hope it is fruitful for everyone and useful for everyone. Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you, Partho. Thank you so much. Now it's time for word of thanks. I would sincerely thank you for our Honorable Founder, President, Chairman Sri Jagdish Bhai Patel, sir, Chairman Sri Dhruv J. Patel, sir, our Campus Director, Sri S.K. Patel, sir, our Joint Managing Trustee, Srimati Kamal J. Patel, ma'am, who have continuously supported and provided this virtual platform. A big thank you to respected Mehul Jadhav, Principal, BITS Institute of Physiotherapy, for giving free hands to organize and conduct such webinars. Thank you, sir. A sincere gratitude to our today's speaker, Partho, for delivering such a practical topic in an innovative way. Thank you, Partho. Sincere thank you to Falgun and Rudra for demonstrating and making this entire session worthy. Thank you, Rudra and Falgun. We are also thankful to Dr. Avani Vasant, ma'am, HOD Computer Department, Babar Institute of Technology, for providing IT support constantly through for this webinar. Last but not the least, we thank you to our student for sharing this session for almost 1.5 hours, and hope everyone would have learned something on foam rolling, the basic concept and few techniques about the foam rolling and joint mobility. So thank you so much, Partho and team, and thank you all the participants, all those students. Thank you so much.
It's our pleasure. Thank you to you also provide us.
And if you have any query, all the students, if you have any query, please drop your all the inquiry on Lux Sports Rehab on Insta and Facebook. All the questions will be answered shortly and quickly. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarfaz. I'll see you. Bye-bye. Thank you, bye. Student. All the best. Bye.